The Conservative Commandos radio show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos radio network. We are establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired of the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos radio network. From 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Saturdays from 2 to 6 p.m. on WNJC Radio, 1360 on your AM dial, or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our website, CCRSNetwork.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where now even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vide, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Vide of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
9/11. It's a day that will go down in our history as the most horrific and destructive scene ever to happen on American soil. It will also be, for most Americans who witnessed it either up close or simply watched in horror on TV, America to participate in a national memorial I call the United Action of Prayer this coming 9/11 and every 9/11 from then on. United Action of Prayer is simply every American stopping whatever they are doing for 1 minute at precisely 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. to either observe 1 minute of silence or pray in memory for the 9/11 victims and their families, and perhaps a prayer of gratitude for living in a country where even 9/11 could not at all weaken the spirit of our great nation. You can call the Conservative Commandos radio show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando radio show.
You are listening to the Conservative Commandos radio network. Monday, the 31st of August in the year of our Lord, 2015. I'm Kevin Wade. And I know you're expecting to hear my regular co-host, the great patriot of the Silver State of Nevada, Sharon Angle. But Sharon is busy traveling from the East Coast back to the West Coast as we speak. And I am delighted to instead be joined in the studio by none other than Rick Trader, our show's producer and inspirational founder. Rick?
Kevin, great to be with you once again. And as I said last week, I always look forward to these opportunities when you and I can work together as opportunities I have to work with Sharon, so it's great to be with you again.
And Sharon's had a big weekend. I was following it in the media. The National Federation of Republican Assemblies was meeting down in Nashville. They're having something of a select your presidential candidate meeting, and they were blessed with the appearance of at least the Donald Trump, who set the place on fire as he does these days. And I understand the event was well attended. I hope to hear some great details when she returns to the show this coming Monday.
I know our friend Anna Little was also down there, so we'll get it from both Sharon and Anna. But are there any other candidates of the 17? Are there any other candidates that people want to hear from other than Donald Trump? I don't think so,
Kevin. I didn't know there was a race. Is there a race this year?
No. There is there, but
someone's going to write a whole series of books about 2015 and 2016, because you can throw all the rules out the window. All of them.
Yes. Kevin, could you imagine what this so-called race would look like without Donald Trump? I mean, no one would be talking about it.
Well, they wouldn't be talking about what they're talking about now, and CNN wouldn't be covering, you know, Republican politics 4 hours every day. This is the most remarkable thing. This Donald Trump, who is filthy rich, okay? Let's be honest. Filthy rich in his own right. Doesn't have to spend his money to get attention because the networks are lining up for interviews. And he can get in front of a microphone and say anything he wants. It doesn't even have to be coherent.
And what amazes me, Kevin, is how it's resonating with the people.
Why is that?
Why is that? Because he is saying, in my opinion, he's saying things that they want to hear.
He's saying, let's talk about some things that no one else is talking about. And people are saying,
right.
Damn right, it's about time.
It's about time. It's about time.
And they may not even agree with his proposed solution. But he's up there talking about it. And people are saying, it's about time. Someone's talking about my life.
Mm-hmm. Interesting, Kevin. There was an article today on the front page, which I didn't read, I got to be honest with you. But the headline was, what Trump is talking about was tried in 1935. Apparently in 1935, during the Great Depression, they kicked out anywhere from 500,000 to a million Mexicans who was here illegally. So I think the paper was... What this particular paper was looking to say is, see, it doesn't work. But in my opinion, I can look at it and say, see, it is possible, it is feasible to deport people, to deport vast numbers of people. Back in 1935, if they deported from 500,000 to a million people, I'm sure today they can do the same thing to 12 to 15 million. Of course, I have my own plan, Kevin. With my plan, you wouldn't need to deport anyone. And my plan is number one, we enforce the laws that we have. The only new law that we need, Kevin, is maybe a change to existing laws, is you put a $100,000 fine on anyone who hires anyone who's here illegally, or a $100,000 fine on anyone who sells or rents a house for an illegal to live in. So if they have nowhere to live, if they have nowhere to earn an income, they will go home on their own just the way they got here.
Well, we are a nation of immigrants. One of the most proud stories in any family is a story of who first came off the boat a long time. We're a nation of immigrants. We
but
love
there's
immigrants.
A difference.
But the difference is our folks knocked on the front door and said, Mother, may I?
Yes.
It was just that simple. And
Absolutely.
Some said yes, some said no.
Absolutely.
So what's happened is, like so many things, mm-hmm. people in Washington took a good thing and ruined it.
Yes.
You didn't break the immigration system. I didn't break it. None of our guests here in the studio broke the immigration system. Washington broke it, like they've broken so many things. And then they say, hey, sorry, middle class America, you've got to pay to fix it. But people in America are now saying, hey, I didn't break it. You guys have to fix it. Before you can fix it, you have to talk about it. So this guy Donald Trump gets up and says most outlandish things, okay? He's over the top. But he's talking about things that are on the minds of the voters for a change.
I agree. And that's why he's so popular right now. That's why he is leading in the poll.
If you're hungry for pizza and you go into your favorite pizza parlor and the waiter or the waitress comes up and says, let me talk to you about snow tires. I mean, your life is going to pivot on snow tires in the next 4 months. Let's talk about snow tires. No, I'm here to get a pizza. No, it's like Washington wants to talk about something else. And because they don't want to talk about what you want to talk about, you're looking for someone who will approach your table and offer a service that you haven't had in a while, like connect with you. And that's what Donald Trump does.
Absolutely. Hey, Kevin, with that, why don't we take our first break and why don't you take us into it?
You are listening to WNJC 1360 AM. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, WNJC 1360 AM. I'm coming from our flagship station in Philadelphia and around the world on the internet at CPR Worldwide Media, Leading Edge Radio Network, TalkStream Live, The Pundit Press, SHR Media, K98 Talk, iHeartRadio, and AM/FM 24/7. And they all end, as you can guess, .com. And you can listen to our show at any time on our website, ccrsnetwork.com and ccrshow.com. I'm Kevin Wade, joined by Rick Trader. You stay with us. We'll be back in about, 3 minutes and 38 seconds.
That's my prerogative. They say I'm messy, but
The Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding. to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We are establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired of the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Saturdays from 2 to 6 p.m. on WNJC Radio, 1360 on your AM dial, or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our website, CCRSNetwork.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where now even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night. At conquered Britain, for freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Vidin of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
9/11. It's a day that will go down in our history as the most horrific and destructive scene ever to happen on American soil. It will also be, for most Americans who witnessed it either up close or simply watched in horror on TV, America to participate in a national memorial I call the United Action of Prayer this coming 9/11 and every 9/11 from then on. United Action of Prayer is simply every American stopping whatever they are doing for 1 minute at precisely 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. to either observe 1 minute of silence or pray in memory for the 9/11 victims and their families, and perhaps a prayer of gratitude for living in a country where even 9/11 could not at all weaken the spirit of our great nation. You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
Thanks for staying with us. If you'd like to hear a rebroadcast of today's show, please check our websites, www.ccrsnetwork.com and www.ccrshow.com, or mornings at 9 a.m., not 8:58, not 8:59, but Mateo, 9 a.m. Log on to leadingedgeradionetwork.com, and now you can listen to the Conservative Commando's Radio Network at any time, any day, from any phone on the planet, by calling 832-999-1199. And I want to remind our listeners that I'm joined in the studio by the studio engineer who is so dominant in the field. He goes by one name, Mateo. It's just Mateo. Some people are just one name. Mateo, Prince, Madonna, Mateo.
Cher.
We'll drop out Liberace. But I need two
Elvis.
Names. Elvis. Exactly.
Elvis is in the house. Mateo is in the house.
It's been a hectic week. The news piles up day by day. What's on your radar screen, Mr. Rick Trader?
Well, let's, if we can, Kevin, because I know you have a commentary.
I do.
Let's go over our guest today, all right?
Very good.
All right. In fact, it is an extreme pleasure to have a guest in studio with us today. Art Harmon is the director of the Coalition to Save Man's Space Exploration. You know, Kevin, I love anything that flies, so Art is a very good friend of mine. He's worked in the public policy arena for three decades in the nation's capital. He's a powerful advocate for launching a bold space program. He's also a photographer. Art, it has been the science and space advisor to Congressman Steve Stockman, and he was also Congressman Stockman's legislative director and policy advisor. So Art is in the studio with us. Art, it's great to have you with it.
Well, thanks so much.
And it's an absolute pleasure to be here in the studio because, you know, we've talked so many times before on the air, but it's always been by phone. And so to be here in the studio with you all today, it's a great pleasure.
Okay, and we're going to be speaking with Art about a couple of columns that he has written and has published on redstate.com. One is President Biden would be Obama's Medvedev, a loyal servant, gives Obama a third term. So we'll be speaking with Art Harmon at 3:35. And Kevin, who will you be speaking with today?
Well, at 4:05, we have Trey Kovacs. He's the labor policy analyst at the Competitive Enterprise Institute. Many of you know that as CEI. He focuses on economic impacts of labor and finance policy. Research areas include public sector unions, labor policy reform, and employer rights. And he's going to be talking about Obama labor regulators set for big changes that help unions, hurt businesses, and don't have much good news for the rest of us. So he's coming in at 4:05. And then at 4:35, we have Frank Vernuccio. He serves as editor-in-chief of the New York Analysis and Policy of the New York Analysis of Policy and Government Organization, providing objective coverage to the key issues facing the U.S. today. He's co-host of the Vernuccio Novak Report next Thursday at 10 a.m. on the broadcast radio and web at amfm247.com. And on Saturdays at 1 p.m. Eastern Time as part of CCRN here on WNJC. And he's going to be talking about attacks on Internet freedom continues.
All right. So we do have a great show lined up. And Kevin,
we always kick off the week well on Mondays here.
Absolutely. And Kevin, you have a commentary for us today.
I do. It's called Time to Protect Our Police. Last week, we saw another tragic shooting of a police officer. Darren Goforth, a deputy sheriff in Harris County, Texas, was killed execution style. He was shot while filling his police cruiser with gas at a local filling station. This followed a shooting death less than a week earlier of a Louisiana state trooper who had stopped to render assistance to a stranded roadside vehicle. So far this year, we have had 22 police officers killed by thugs in the performance of their public safety duties. This does not include loss of life due to accidents and mishaps in the course of their daily duties as officers of the law. The police in any community are the firewall between your peace and safety and the chaos of self-destruction that lives in the criminal pockets on the fringe of society. When trouble strikes, it is the police who move to contain it. They are the few who are given the responsibility to subdue the instigators and prevent its spread into a general lawlessness. While we can lock our doors and gather our loved ones in the face of danger, it is the police who must move out into harm's way to confront, contain, and end the violence. These police who stand between us and danger all day, every day, deserve our respect and admiration. More than that, they deserve our support as they do their work. When police arrive on the scene, they must make sense of often senseless situations. There's no other profession tasked with the same requirements to make snap judgments in confused and dangerous settings, to decide in an instant how to defuse a situation, to prevent an escalation, to contain a problem, and if needed, make an arrest or use force to restrain a belligerent, is a demand we place on police every day. It is an almost impossible demand we make for perfection. Yet police almost always get it right. Recently, we've seen political figures, all the political left, play a dangerous game. They blame police organizations for doing the needed police work in their own communities. Communities broken and made dysfunctional by the public policies of the left itself. Deluded political figures who make heroes of street thugs and corner drug dealers while those same figures blame the police. The police who stand bravely to guard and protect innocent citizens trapped by the chaos made by the left. While the left panders to the bottom feeders, stores are looted and buildings burn, unwilling to assume responsibility for the breakdown in the communities they are supposed to lead, these leftist leaders seek one more target to blame while denying their own roles in creating decay and anger. This pandering and these false accusations embolden sick individuals to lash out against those few remaining guardians of decency in society, the police. There is no doubt that this pandering by the left has led to the deaths of police officers in this country. We as a nation need to denounce the pandering left as the political grifters and hustlers they are today. The return to law and order requires we replace these hired hucksters with real leadership that returns law and order and peace to our communities. So it comes down to us, as it always does. There is nothing so effective as a community that embraces and welcomes good policing and pushes back the forces of chaos and disorder. For the police to protect us, we need to provide a sure and safe haven of protection for the police. I'm Kevin Wade, and that's the way I see it, Rick.
Well, Kevin, when you have people like Barack Obama, and by the way, I think you can see an escalation of the shooting of police officers in the last couple of years since the Trayvon Martin incident, also what went on in Ferguson, Missouri. But I think this culture at disrespecting police officers started 5 or 6 years ago when you had Barack Obama talking about the police involving an incident with a professor at Harvard, when he said the police acted stupidly. He didn't know any of the details. But in his opinion, it was the police that acted stupidly, Kevin. And, you know, we see we're talking these community organizers, these community groups that, for instance, the Hands Up, Don't Shoot crowd, who took a very unfortunate incident and turned it into a lie. Went with the Hands Up, Don't Shoot. Making heroes out of thugs, as you talk about, is very dangerous, because when your thugs become your heroes, who are your real heroes, Kevin? They take the heroes and make the heroes, which are the police, the villains. It's very dangerous, Kevin.
Yeah, well, you won't see these political leaders stand up and say, I've made a mess of this community. I and people like me
Have
put forth and imposed policies on an entire population here for 30 years, and it's broken down the fabric of this town. Those who prosper are drug dealers on a street corner. Those who prosper are shakedown artists who threaten to use violence against shopkeepers. That's the world we've created. Now, the leaders of the left won't take responsibility for the monster they've created. And that final firewall are the police force.
They're making it worse, Kevin. Kevin, they're making it worse. When you got a mayor of a city like Baltimore who basically gives the rooters and the rioters free hand to do what they will do, oh my gosh, we don't have leadership, Kevin. You're absolutely right.
We don't
right.
have honest leadership.
We don't have leadership
but,
at all.
But thank goodness most people have a common sense meter that they know has been bent and twisted by the folks in Washington. And I think this is part of this wide story that America is really coming to understand how bankrupt liberal politics and politicians are. There's nothing that substantiates what they're trying to do. It's just empty promise after empty promise, broken despair and anger that emerges when people realize that after 20 and 30 years, things are getting worse in their communities.
Who are you going to call, Kevin, when you can't call the police?
The police are the people you call.
When
there's no place else to turn, when no one else can handle something, that's when you call the police.
And if
the police aren't willing to come out because they have been targeted by, quote-unquote, the political leadership in a community, who do you go to? There's no one to go to. Now you're talking about a survival of the fittest.
Hmm. And then you got this culture of don't tell. You've got a lot of people in the communities who know who are committing these crimes, but there's this culture of don't snitch, don't tell, who don't help the situation.
Well, we're coming up to the end of the first half hour. I want to thank you for staying with us. We are WNJC 1360 AM, and we're coming to you live from our Philadelphia studios, broadcasting around the Philadelphia Valley. And across the fruited plains on the internet at Leading Edge Radio, Talk Stream Live, The Pundit Press, K98 Talk, and a whole bunch of other places. You stay with us. We will be right back with Art Harmon, our first guest, in about 6 minutes.
You've heard Paul Deltz playing the music on the Your Music Matters Morning Show. He is also an experienced mortgage loan officer working for U.S. Mortgage Corporation and assists homeowners navigate the reverse mortgage process. If you are finding yourself asking questions whether or not you set aside enough for retirement, Paul can sit down with you, your family, and your financial advisor and discuss how a reverse mortgage may be a valuable resource for your retirement plan. You will be responsible for paying your taxes and insurance, and the reverse mortgage can help with this and other expenses, such as home health care or other untimely bills. Put Paul's 20-plus years of experience to work for you, as choosing the right option for your situation can be critical. Call Paul at U.S. Mortgage Corporation at 877-213-9977. That's 877-213-9977. Or go to seniormatters.info for more information. U.S. Mortgage Corporation is a licensed mortgage banker in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, and Delaware, and an equal housing lender. NMLS number 3901. U.S. Mortgage Corporation is located at 201 Old Country Road, Suite 140, Melville, New York, 11747. This advertisement applies to first lien mortgages. Paul E. Dilks, NMLS, is 485904.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Vine, Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
What does it take to be the leader in production systems technology? To be the one company that solves production problems at any plant, for any product, and with any technology? It takes a 30-year record of success. It takes total mastery of complex technologies with a history of delivering success every time, without fail. Only one company can claim that high ground in manufacturing line optimization, data automation, and systems integration, and that's Philadelphia Control Systems. In factories worldwide, Philadelphia Control Systems programs, software, and engineering solutions deliver optimal performance and output flow with a record that can't be matched. Any plant, any product, any technology. Philadelphia Control Systems, the leader in production automation since 1982. 800-335-9811. PCSforAutomation.com. That's PCS, the number 4, automation.com.
The Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We're establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired as I am about the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. on WNJC Radio 1360 AM or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our websites, ConservativeCommandosRadioNetwork.com and CCRN.com for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where even more newsmakers go to be heard.
9/11. It's a day that will go down in our history as the most horrific and destructive scene ever to happen on American soil. It will also be, for most Americans who witnessed it either up close or simply watched in horror on TV, America to participate in a national memorial I call the United Action of Prayer this coming 9/11 and every 9/11 from then on. United Action of Prayer is simply...
American stopping whatever they are doing for 1 minute at precisely 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. to either observe 1 minute of silence or pray in memory for the 9/11 victims and their families, and perhaps a prayer of gratitude for living in a country where even 9/11 could not at all weaken the spirit of our great nation. From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the Internet, we're coming to you live from the CCRS studios, WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos Radio Show, where the newsmakers go to be heard. Businessman there, drink my wine. You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
That was Congressman Alan West, but you are listening to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. I'm Kevin Wade, joined by Rick Trader today. If you'd like to hear a rebroadcast of today's show, please check out our website, ccrsnetwork.com and ccrshow.com. Or mornings at 9 a.m., log on to leadingedgeradionetwork.com, and you can listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network at any time, any day, from any telephone on the planet Earth, by calling 832-999-1199. If you're calling from Antarctica, some toll charges might apply. Check with your service provider. I'm Kevin Wade. Rick Trader's in the studio with me, and so is our first guest. Rick, you want to take it away?
Absolutely. And joining us today is a very good friend of mine and that of the Conservative Commandos Radio Show, and that is Art Harmon. Art is the director of the Coalition to Save Manned Space Exploration. He's worked in public policy arenas for three decades. And as you could tell, he would be a powerful advocate for launching a bold space program. He's also a policy analyst in other fields of importance, and as a television producer and photographer. Art was also the science and space advisor to Congressman Steve Stockman and Congressman Stockman's legislative director and policy advisor. Again, Art, it's great to have you in studio here at the Conservative Commandos Radio Show.
Well, thanks so much, Rick and Kevin, and I'm so excited to be here in the studio for the first time.
Yeah. We've been wanting to do this for quite some time, and it just coincidentally worked out today. So it's absolutely great to have you with us. And Art, we've asked you to join us today to discuss a couple of the articles that you have posted on redstate.com, especially this first article. It doesn't get any more timely. President Biden would be Obama's Medvedev, a loyal servant that will give Obama a third term. And Art Harmon, what do you mean by that?
Well, let's take a look at two things. Number one is, of course, this president's goals. What did he say in his 08 campaign? That we're going to have a fundamental transformation of the United States. Mm-hmm. And that is not in the direction of more freedom, but it's in the direction of more socialism and to tear down relations with our allies and support our enemies. And so his term's coming to an end. He's got less than 18 months left. And there's a lot he can do by executive action, but there'll be a lot that he'll want to do when he gets on that helicopter and people cheer his departure. Mm-hmm. So what if he could get a third term? He was actually saying the other day, if I had a third term, I'd get elected. And given his propensity for executive action, unilateral dictator-like action, you know, there's a lot of people that think he would just love to scrap the Constitution and say, you know, I'm your president for life. Mm-hmm. But there's a model he can follow. And many people will remember that in 2012, there was an exchange between Russia's president, Dmitry Medvedev, where, because you remember, Putin was president, and then there was a term limit for him, so he had to step down. And he put in his place this puppet, this really weak guy named Medvedev. And but everyone knew, it was just total common knowledge, that Medvedev is Putin's puppet. Mm-hmm. And Putin says, you know, jump, and he just says, how high? So the puppet in chief for that time, until Putin then, with a one-term separation, could reassert his formal title as president. But in 2012, there was that really disturbing thing, which none of the Republican presidential candidates took advantage of. You know, it was like they wanted to lose. They were designated losers, you know. And so Obama is discussing disarmament of the United States to Medvedev. And in particular, how, you know, he wanted to get rid of any missile defense. So Medvedev, instead of saying, you know, very good, he showed what sort, you know, sort of a subservient puppet he is. And he said, Obama said, this is my last election. After the election, I will have more flexibility. Now, they didn't know they were on a hot mic, because they'd been talking, you know, giving their little official statement, but the mics were on. And every once in a while, you'll catch Washington officials in great comments. Well, you know, the most pleasantly famous was by our own Ronald Reagan, who said, you know, in 5 minutes, we start bombing Russia. And, of course, in Russia, there's, oh, my God, oh, my God. But no, it was a joke. But it showed, you know, Reagan was a tough guy who meant peace through strength, and he really meant it, and he gave it to us. But Medvedev didn't say, oh, you know, very good, I understand. No, Medvedev said, I understand. I will transmit this information to Vladimir Putin. So he was saying, you know, I'm going to tell my boss. Mm-hmm. And it might be that exchange gave Obama the idea, oh, wait, what if I put a puppet in my place? What if my little bumbling fool of a Senator Biden, who's my vice president, can become my puppet in chief? And every morning he'll call me up and say, what are my orders for the day? And I spoke to this guy, you know, what should I tell him? You know, be just like right. that.
And, well, you know, Art, for one thing, there is no love lost between the Obamas and the Clintons.
Oh, bingo. Bingo.
There's no love lost. And I believe that with this mess, that Obama's quite happy about this mess. He's certainly not unhappy. I believe he's quite happy about it.
Yes, yes, yes. But it goes one step further. If you look up some recent commentary by Monica Crowley, she's been doing reporting on how this might have been a setup from the very beginning, that Obama himself, or through one of his people, he may have said, you know, set up your own private email. You know, we can keep some of this stuff off the official radar. It won't be easily obtained through freedom of information if no one knows about it. What will they? They won't know what to ask for.
Well, of course, there's some precedent when you talk about email servers. When you talk about private emails, there are several members of the Obama administration that has now shown to have had separate email accounts under fictitious names.
Yeah, Lois Lerner.
Lois Lerner.
Others. Yeah, sure.
The administrator for the EPA.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So, you know, Hillary Clinton is not the first that we found out that had private email service, private email accounts under fictitious names. Seems to be running rampant in that Obama administration.
Oh, indeed. And
hey, Art, we have to take a quick break. Could you hold on for just 2 minutes for us, please?
Always.
And you are listening to the Conservative Commandos radio show with Kevin Wade and yours truly, Rick Trader, today coming to you live from the studios of the Conservative Commandos radio network. WNJC 1360, our flagship station in Philadelphia, and around the world on the internet with CPR Worldwide Media, Leading Edge Radio Network, TalkStream Live, The Pun and Press, SHR Media, K98 Talk, iHeartRadio, and AM/FM 24/7, and they're all .coms. You can also check out our website, ccrshow.com and ccrsnetwork.com. Today's show, like all our shows, is brought to you by the First Amendment, protected by the Second. We'll be right back with our guest, Art Harmon.
The Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We are establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired of the Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Saturdays from 2 to 6 p.m. on WNJC Radio, 1360 on your AM dial, or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our website, CCRSNetwork.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where now even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Vidin of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
9/11. It's a day that will go down in our history as the most horrific and destructive scene ever to happen on American soil. It will also be, for most Americans who witnessed it either up close or simply watched in horror on TV, America to participate in a national memorial I call the United Action of Prayer this coming 9/11 and every 9/11 from then on. United Action of Prayer is simply every American stopping whatever they are doing for 1 minute at precisely 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. to either observe 1 minute of silence or pray in memory for the 9/11 victims and their families, and perhaps a prayer of gratitude for living in a country where even 9/11 could not at all weaken the spirit of our great nation. You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
Welcome back to the Commando's Radio Show with Kevin Wade and yours truly, Rick Trader. And if you'd like to hear podcasts of today's show, please check out our websites, ccrshow.com or ccrsnetwork.com. Or mornings at 9 a.m., log on to leadingedgeradionetwork.com. But you could also hear our show any time of the day from your telephone by calling 832-999-1199. Joining us in studio today is Art Harmon. He's the director of the Coalition to Save Manned Space Exploration. Art was also the science and space advisor to Congressman Steve Stockman and was Congressman Stockman's legislative director and policy advisor. Art, thanks for holding through that break. We appreciate your time.
Always a pleasure, Rick and Kevin.
We're talking with you about the article that you have written and is up on redstate.com right now. President Obama would be, cut my tongue out. President Biden would be Obama's Medvedev. A loyal servant gives Obama a third term. And just as we're going to break, we're talking about Monica Crowley and her belief that
it was probably Barack Obama himself who gave the idea to Hillary Clinton of a private email server.
Indeed, because that gives him leverage later. He can use it to destroy her. He can use it to blackmail her, in effect, or control her in various ways by saying, this just might get out into the media. You had your own server. Now, some of the, here's something that almost makes you cry about just one of the leaked emails that was about Benghazi and how the a U.S. ambassador there, who was killed, of course, how he was discussing the bad security and discussing his future movements. Now, we know that was an unsecured server, and probably every intelligence system in the world, down to, smallest, probably Monaco was spying on him, because they could, as well as every terrorist group. So it is very possible that our ambassador and the other three, they were that night in Libya, Benghazi, were killed because of that leaked email. So the terrorists may have known where they were and what they were doing and their escape plans and whatever. This is just, it just makes me want to cry. With Congressman Stockman, we worked on that issue with trying to expose the truth, and all these things they wouldn't release. This might be why.
It's unbelievable from what I understand about this whole Benghazi mess in the beginning, that Ambassador Stevens was actually in Benghazi putting together press coverage that Hillary Clinton was supposed to come into Benghazi to do some sort of a press conference, and that's why he was there in Benghazi in the first place.
Fascinating.
And that, we all know the results of what happened there. I wonder, Art, and maybe we can bring Kevin Wade into this conversation at this point, talking about Joe Biden. Joe Biden just lost a son, a very close son. And it seems to me a little funny that he is now coming out and looking like he wants to run. After all, he went up to Massachusetts to meet with Elizabeth Warren.
Right.
Who's
as far left or more as Obama.
Yeah. I'd love to have been a fly on the wall in that conversation. But here you have a man who just lost his son, who's grieving over his son. But he's being opportunistic when he sees Hillary crashing in the polls to make or possibly potentially make a run for the White House. Kevin, I don't know. I am not a father. You are. If I just lost a son, I think running for president would be one of the last things on my mind that I'd want to do.
Well, I can't speak to how other families work, but I know in my own family, the last conversation you'd want to have with a loved one is about politics.
Yeah.
But to get back to Monica Crowley and something you mentioned, Art, apparently Hillary, our former Secretary of State, former First Lady, former U.S. Senator from the Empire State of New York, is under investigation at the moment by the FBI. The FBI reports, as I understand, to the Attorney General, ultimately.
Yep.
And the Attorney General reports to whom? Art?
The president. And you know what? This is what's so fishy, because there have been so many examples where the Justice Department has refused to investigate or prosecute people who really, really desperately need it.
Because of, our side would say is a terrible politicization of a law enforcement.
Bingo. Yeah, sure. And so why would this, of all people, the Secretary of State go forward when the others don't?
Well, there will be a decision made whether or not there's enough evidence to warrant charges being placed, yes?
Absolutely. Now
that's going to go to the highest levels.
It will. Now, Hillary is not defenseless. She has her political operation. They will do everything they can to keep it quiet, to delay it, do everything to get her past the nomination before something really, really bad splats across the front page of the newspapers. But on the other side, you know, you've got the two of the most powerful political machines in the country, and they are going to be pitted against each other. It's going to be a gloriously bloody battle.
Ooh. Ooh.
And maybe this Martin O'Malley starts looking better every day.
Well, Kevin and Art, it's my thinking at this point is that Obama is ready to pull out all stops for Joe.
That's your take? Mm-hmm. Because of the Medvedev connection?
I think Barack Obama smells Hillary Clinton's blood in the water.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and she's damn it. But I don't know what you got.
He controls
I think,
her political future.
Yeah, he's been throwing the chum in the water.
Because if they do decide to indict her, to press charges,
mm-hmm.
Even if there's like a grand jury, all it takes is a couple leaks.
Yep.
And she's toast. She's either toast before their nominating convention, or her opportunity to be elected is toasted afterwards, because that will be all the talk should she be the candidate.
Oh, we could only pray.
Well, you know, another thing I've noticed in absence of, where are the Democrats from this administration or high in the Democrat Party? They are not coming out to defend Hillary Clinton. It's like she is an orphan. They've cut her off. Have you noticed?
Yeah.
No one's out there defending her.
And the grassroots is turning to Mr. Charisma, the Winston Churchill of the 21st century of the left, Bernie Sanders. Okay, he's getting 20,000 people to his public events. So they're something different in the grassroots level.
And what they're seeing is, here's an opportunity to elect somebody even more far left than Hillary. And so they're all getting excited. But it's kind of ironic that Hillary, who had been going around saying, you know, there's this vast right-wing conspiracy that's after me. Well, it looks like the vast conspiracy that's going to take her down is really going to be not the right-wing conspiracy, but the vast West Wing conspiracy.
West Wing. That's Art Harmon, folks. You write that one down. It's a West Wing.
You heard
conspiracy.
It here first. Well, Art, I want to thank you so much for joining us on the Conservative Commandos radio show. It's been a great conversation. We also wanted to get into China with you, but that'll be for another day. But Art, I love how you end your piece. That's on Red State. You say, should Obama's gambit pay off, perhaps Biden will tell Putin at their first meeting, quote, "I understand. I will transmit this information back to Barack."
Just like Medvedev said.
Yeah. Art Harmon, we want to thank you for joining us. And please tell our audience where they can follow your work.
Follow me on Red State. I publish there from time to time. And between now and middle of this coming week, this week, call your congressman, call your senators, tell them vote no on the vote for the Iran bill to defeat the Obama's giving and paying for Iran's bomb. That's very important.
Art Harmon, want to thank you so much. I always love talking with the artist, especially when we talk things in space. I remember maybe about a year or so when that asteroid blew up over Russia. We had you on and talking about that.
Well, he claimed credit, didn't he?
Yeah.
Didn't he claim credit for that?
He did. And Kevin said to me, he says, at that point, he says, I don't know where you got this. How'd you pull this guy out of the hat?
So quick.
This happened, this explosion. But Art Harmon, again, thank you so much for joining us on the Conservative
And thanks
Canada's
for being with us in our studio.
I'm so pleased to be in the studio. Thank you all so much.
We're coming to you live from the Conservative Commandos Radio Network Studios, WNJC 1360, our flagship station in Philadelphia, and around the world on the Internet with CPR Worldwide Media, Leading Edge Talk Stream Live, Abundant Press, SHR Media, K98 Talk, iHeart Radio, and AM, FM, 24/7. They all end in .com. And you can listen to this show anytime from our website, ccrsnetwork.com and ccrshow.com. I'm Kevin Wade, joined by Rick Trader. We will be right back.
Oh! 1360 AM, WNJC.
WNJC,
Washington Township,
Philadelphia.
That's my prerogative. They say I'm messy, but I...
The Conservative Commandos radio show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos radio network. We are establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired of the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos radio network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Saturdays from 2 to 6 p.m. on WNJC Radio, 1360 on your AM dial, or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our website, CCRSNetwork.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos radio network, where now even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Vidin of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
9/11. It's a down in our history as the most horrific and destructive scene ever to happen on American soil. It will also be, for most Americans who witnessed it either up close or simply watched in horror on TV, America to participate in a national memorial I call the United Action of Prayer this coming 9/11 and every 9/11 from then on. United Action of Prayer is simply every American stopping whatever they are doing for 1 minute at precisely 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. to either observe 1 minute of silence or pray in memory for the 9/11 victims and their families, and perhaps a prayer of gratitude for living in a country where even 9/11 could not at all weaken the spirit of our great nation. You can call the Conservative Commandos radio show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando radio show.
You are listening to the Conservative Commando's radio show. That was a very short break. If you'd like to hear a rebroadcast of today's show, please check our website, ccrsnetwork.com, ccrshow.com, or mornings at 9 a.m. log on to leadingedgeradionaut.com. And you can listen to the Conservative Commando's radio show at any time, any day, from any telephone by calling 832-999-1199. I'm Kevin Wade. It's Monday, the 31st of August. I'll tell you, this year, 2005, is flying past. My regular co-host and dear friend Sharon Angle is in transit between Nashville, Tennessee, and her home near Reno, and unable to be on the show with us. And her microphone is adequately, and then some, being filled by our show's inspirational leader and founder, Rick Trader. Our next guest will be up in just a minute, and that is Trey Kovacs. He's a labor policy analyst at Competitive Enterprise Institute, and he's going to talk about some of the recent Obama labor regulations that are really going to be setting business back on its heels in a business environment where, well, things really aren't that good right now. So with that, let's bring Trey Kovacs in. Trey, this is Kevin Wade. You are on the Conservative Commandos radio show. Thanks for being with us.
Oh, well, thank you for having me.
What in the world is President Obama's labor regulators up to these days?
Well, unfortunately, they're up to a lot. Recently, they've finalized one regulation and had a decision come out and have proposed another regulation that's all going to be harmful to workers and employers and job creation. One of the rules that's already in effect is the National Labor Relations Board ambush election rule, which really hinders employees' ability to get the facts on organizing and speeds up the process to give them little time to think about whether unionizing is good or bad for them. In addition to that, it really jeopardizes workers' privacy. Employers, under this new rule, once a union has petitioned to organize a group of workers, will have to hand over their personal telephone numbers, email addresses, home addresses, work schedules, and all of these, you know, there's inherent risk of identity theft, intimidation, and all sorts of other unintended consequences that the NLRB really didn't take into account when implementing this rule.
Is there any sense of logic or precedence driving these rules? Is this something that our world has been demanding a problem be remedied, or is this just kind of blatant partisanship at work?
Well, so no one has been clamoring for the ambush election rule change other than unions, who have seen declining union membership for decades, and this rule is essentially designed to tilt the playing field in unions' favor to organize more employees and to collect more forced union dues payments.
Now, is there an appellate court? Is there a bench? Is there some other judge that a business or an industry marketing group can go to have their interests represented to say, hey, this ruling from the NLRB is bad for us, it's bad for business? How do you seek a remedy?
Well, so unfortunately, two federal district courts have already sided in favor of the NLRB and said the rule stands. And that's because all these courts give deference to these agencies and say, you know, basically that the NLRB are all experts in the labor field and that they know what's best, even though these are unelected. Who really have the power of Congress by these courts upholding all of these outrageous regulations.
Now, where does the U.S. House come into play? I mean, don't they have oversight responsibilities? Don't they have the purse strings in their hands that they can intervene?
Well, right. So that's the way they've had hearings and they've, you know, brought people in and discussed this rule. But what really Congress can do is, in the appropriations process, withhold all funding to these outrageous rules coming out of the NLRB and Department of Labor. Simply, all Congress has to do is nothing. Don't pass these appropriation bills and have provisions within them, if they were to be passed, to withhold funding to enforce the ambush election. It's that simple.
And they certainly have the ability to hold hearings.
Yeah, and they've held hearings multiple times on the ambush election rule that's already in place, and the decision that came down recently where the NLRB redefined what a joint employer is, and the House and Workforce Committee has also had hearings on the Department of Labor's proposed overtime rule. So they've done, you know, their due diligence in respect to having hearings. Now it's time for Congress really to act and withhold funding from these labor agencies.
And Trey, what do you think are the chances of that happening?
Well, you know, Republicans really don't want to be blamed for shutting down government. The odds are slim, but it is somewhat hopeful that they have included in draft appropriations bills withholding funding from the ambush election rule. Now, whether that will be in the final version that's passed, you know, that's anyone's guess. I would say no. But, I mean, really now it's for people to get out there and really tell Congress and reach out to the representative to say, you know, this rule really isn't good for workers, for business, job creation, and any of these things. And, you know, these unelected bureaucrats at the NLRB shouldn't have the power of law, and they should be, funding should be withheld.
Yeah, and they certainly don't have responsibilities to try to make payroll on payday, as do all the small business owners across the 50 states.
Yeah.
Who more than have their hands full in normal times covering payroll. And now they're being advised that in a 14-day period, they could end up having a hostile union organized in that some casual salaried employees are suddenly going to be receiving overtime payments for jobs that traditionally did not include overtime for the past, life of the business. And there's no way to cover that gap. So it seems to be, this seems to be another example of just Washington putting their nose in too many tents and getting things turned upside down with no understanding of the consequences to everyday Americans and everyday small business in America.
Yeah, and that's really the problem, is that with all of these federal labor agencies, they're really, all they're doing is interfering with common business practices and workers' rights to freedom of association. And really, they have no business telling companies, you know, whether certain employees should or should not receive overtime, or, you know, how quickly a union election takes, and whether an employer has to give away employees' private information, or, you know, whether one company is liable for another company's employees. I mean, really, these federal labor agencies are far, you know, overreaching their power and what Congress intended them to do, and now it's time for Congress to withhold their funding until they act as Congress intended.
But then again, getting back to the original problem is we have leadership in the House of Representatives that doesn't want to get blamed for actually doing anything.
Right, and so that's the problem. And you know, elections are coming up soon, so, I mean, you would hope, you know, a new set of elected officials, you know, come into office who are willing to actually do what's best.
Yeah, which is to make their case for the American people, argue it, win the case, and challenge the White House and the administration on problems just identical to this. So, I mean, I guess that describes some background into why so many dedicated Republicans and certainly conservatives feel abandoned by Republicans in Washington.
Yes, that's, I mean, because it's very, I mean, they know what they have to do. I mean, with these rules coming out, you know, at a rapid pace during the Obama administration, and, you know, I only cover, you know, a couple of them, they have the tools available to them. They have the power of the purse. Now it's, you know, their opportunity to exercise.
Well, I think we have plenty of Republicans in Washington. What we lack is courage. Let's talk about this overtime rule. Proposed requirements would extend mandatory overtime payments to salaried employees who earn $50,440 annually or less, up from the current threshold. Would even cover workers, and I'm reading from your article, it would even cover workers who perform mainly professional or managerial tasks.
Yeah, and so really what this rule does is it's going to take away flexible work arrangements. When it includes people who are doing managerial and professional tasks, these workers are allowed to basically paid to get the job done. What the rule is going to do is make them have to work to punch a clock. And so now if you're a professional employee, if your child's sick, or if you have to run an errand at work, you can go do that and come back and finish the job, you know, at a different time, at home. You can work from home and do all of these other things that give you flexibility. But with this overtime rule, employers are going to have to track all of your hours. So they're not going to want you to work from home because they can't as easily track what you're doing. They're going to not allow you to check emails at home or make any phone calls at home or after hours because they may, you know, if you're over your 40 hours a week, they may have to pay you time and a half. So all really what the main problem with this rule is that the Obama administration is claiming that workers are going to get this huge pay raise. They're saying 5 million employees will be affected and workers, you know, will add as much as $1.3 billion to workers' wages. But really, that's not going to happen because employers are going to figure out how to keep pay constant. They're going to either turn you into a part-time employee, cut your hours, or they're going to lower your base pay. So when you do work overtime, you're going to be making the same amount. And on average, if you spread it across the whole economy, that $1.3 billion that workers are going to get averages out to only $260 a year. So you're really, these workers aren't going to get a pay raise from this. But what is going to happen is they're going to lose flexible work arrangements that lots of workers have become accustomed to.
And value. And if they didn't appreciate those arrangements, they would put in their resignation letter and go. But again, as you said, Trey, this intrudes in the freedom of association as an employee with an employer in a free economy.
Trey, we
have a break coming up. Would you stay with us through the break so that we could pick up this conversation on the other side?
Yeah, sounds good.
We're on the phone with Trey Kovacs. He's a labor policy analyst at the Competitive Enterprise Institute, CEI, as we know them. He's going to stay with us. I'd like to ask you, our audience, stay with us, too. We will be right back in about 4 minutes.
The Conservative Commandos radio show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos radio network. We are establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired of the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos radio network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Saturdays from 2 to 6 p.m. on WNJC Radio, 1360 on your AM dial, or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our website, CCRSNetwork.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos radio network, where now even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. A declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Vidin of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
9/11. It's a day that will go down in our history as the most horrific and destructive scene ever to happen on American soil. It will also be, for most Americans who witnessed it either up close or simply watched in horror on TV, America, to participate in a national memorial I call the United Action of Prayer this coming 9/11 and every 9/11 from then on. United Action of Prayer is simply every American stopping whatever they are doing for 1 minute at precisely 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. to either observe 1 minute of silence or pray in memory for the 9/11 victims and their families, and perhaps a prayer of gratitude for living in a country where even 9/11 could not at all weaken the spirit of our great nation. You can call the Conservative Commandos radio show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
Thank you, Colonel West. You are listening to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. If you'd like to hear a rebroadcast of today's show, please check out our websites, www.ccrsnetwork.com and www.ccrshow.com, or mornings at 9 a.m. Log on to Leading Edge Radio Network. Now you can listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network at any time, any day, from any telephone on the planet by calling 832-999-1199. We're on the phone with Trey Kovacs. He's labor policy analyst at Competitive Enterprise Institute. His writings have been featured in American Spectator, The Washington Times, Capital Research Center's Labor Watch, and he's also a regular contributor to openmarket.org. And he's staying with us talking about the new Obama labor regulations setting up big changes, and not good changes, in the American workplace. Trey, how did the NLRB get so politicized? Did that board have a conservative free enterprise bent to it?
Yes, basically there's five members to the NLRB and the president gets to appoint the members. So depending on, you know, who holds, you know, the executive office, it tilts either, you know, one way or the other. But that's really been the problem with the NLRB, really, since its inception, is because it was meant to be a neutral arbiter that decides labor cases in the public interest. And what's happened is that it's become politicized, and you have, you know, all this uncertainty in the labor field because, you know, from administration to administration, they tilt it, you know, either towards employers or towards unions. And so really what needs to be done is to overhaul the National Labor Relations Act that created the NLRB and just send these, you know, labor cases to a federal district court. Like you said, it's become so politicized, it's really outlived its usefulness, and you have great uncertainty that is really harmful to job creation, employers, and workers.
And correct me if I'm wrong, the NLRB dates back to the days of Franklin Roosevelt, the Great Depression. Am I right about that, or am I missing?
Yeah, it was a New Deal creation.
Okay.
Yeah, so they're celebrating its 80th year or 80th anniversary this year. So I would say it's about time for some change.
Yeah, because the world has changed. Back in those days, you would have 20,000 workers going to Ford's River Rouge plant every day. And that doesn't happen anymore. We're in a different world with a lot of contending interests and a lot of pressures on business to adapt. And it's very difficult to adapt when you have an opponent in Washington putting his thumb on the scale, trying to run you out of business because they don't know any better.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's really what you're seeing with all of these rules, is they're trying to make it as difficult as possible for businesses to engage in these newer business practices like contracting out work, franchise, and not that any of these are super new, but when you're dealing with an agency that's been around for 80 years, they're new to them, and what they keep claiming is that the law hasn't kept up with these new business practices, so we need to step in and interfere with employers and workers who are agreeing to contract with each other.
But it's not a question of the law keeping up, it's the fact that the economy has outlaw. Because the law serves no useful purpose anymore. Again, it's not 20,000 workers punching a time clock as they enter the River Rouge plant south of Detroit. There are 10,001 different ways of working today, some of which are good and some of which, unfortunately, are not so good. But that's the competitive marketplace we are now in. And when the Obama administration cuts loose the NLRB to promulgate some of these rules, it just gives one more reason for the next American business to move to China.
Yes, absolutely. And that's the NLRB's argument of why they're overreaching their power and change, you know, in promulgating all these rules, is because they want to go back to that time where 10,000, 20,000 workers, you know, are going to one, you know, big corporation, work these rigid 8-hour days, and, you know, all workers are treated the same, because that eases organizing campaigns for unions. So they can organize one large target and one group of workers and become entrenched, and it's very hard to get rid of a union once they're in there.
Trey, my co-host today, our show's founder, in fact, Rick Trader, has a question for you. Rick?
Yeah, here on the Conservative Commandos radio show, we're speaking with Trey Kovacs. He's a policy, he's a labor policy analyst at the Competitive Enterprise Institute. Trey, as you and Kevin were speaking, I was perusing through my emails, and there's an article here on the Daily Signal written by Kate Scanlon, who has been a guest here on our show several times. And it just shows what happens when the cost of doing business rises, the reaction that the business takes. Walmart reduces employee hours following wage increase. Walmart has been reducing the number of hours employees work in some of its stores following a wage increase earlier this year, according to a report from Bloomberg. So this is cause and effect, Trey. Price of business, or the price for doing business, goes up. Business will find a way to reduce those costs. And what I believe what happens, get your opinion, is those who are supposed to be affected the most are the ones that are hurt the most. And here we got employees losing hours because of wage increases.
Yeah, I mean, that's what you see, you know, with the Department of Labor's proposed overtime rule. It's meant to give these workers a raise, but really what's going to happen is you're going to see reduced hours, less flexible schedule, and reduced base pay. A report from a Bureau of Labor Statistics economist came out and said that these overtime rules, what's going to happen is 80% of that cost is going to come from reducing base pay. And this, it's the same thing that you see when you see hikes to the minimum wage.
Yeah. You know, Trey, and it seems to me, you know, we've got the Competitive Enterprise Institute out there doing its part. You've got us here at the Conservative Commandos doing its part. But you've got the left out there, and they have their narrative. And their narrative sounds like, oh, we're for the working man. We're for the working class. It doesn't seem like the right or conservatives has a narrative to combat the narrative coming from the left.
Well, I mean, I think that is true, and that's what the narrative of the left is, like you said, you know, oh, we're for the working man and, you know, the poor and the weak. But what's, they get exposed on the occasion, like you've seen in the $15 minimum wage increase that was proposed in Los Angeles. And that hit a huge speed bump when the union that was prominently pushing for this increase to the minimum wage at the last minute slipped in an exemption for union businesses from that $15 minimum wage. And then the $15 minimum wage in LA didn't get passed ultimately. So they're exposed on the occasion, but I do agree that our side needs to have a better narrative and, you know, talk about worker freedom more often and the rights of employees, rather than always talking about the employer or businesses, and kind of have more of these stories where workers have, you know, been intimidated by unions and, you know, had, you know, lost their jobs from the minimum wage increases, and have a different narrative than talking, you know, these big numbers, you know, how this rule will, you know, impact, you know, millions of people, and focus more on the individual person who is hurt by these regulations rather than, you know, the economy at large.
Well, Trey, I think the message is something like you can never have a great second job if the liberals prevent you ever from getting that first starting job. Hey, Trey, we're coming up on the end of the segment. Will you tell our listeners how to keep up with your writings?
Yeah, that's what. Check out CEI.org. The Open Market blog has a lot of the writings, as well as WorkplaceChoice.org, which is the Competitive Enterprise Institute's labor blog.
Trey Kovacs, Competitive Enterprise Institute, thank you so much for being with us today.
All right. Thank you.
You are listening to the Conservative Commandos radio show. We're coming to you live from CCRS and Network Studios, WNJC 1360 AM, our flagship station, and around the world on the Internet at CPR Worldwide Media, Leading Edge Radio Network, Talk Stream Live, The Pundit Press, SHR Media 98, K98 Talk, iHeart Radio, and AM, FM 24/7. They all end in .com, and you can listen to our show at any time from our websites, CCRSnetwork.com and CCRShow.com. I'm Kevin Wade, joined by Rick Trader. We're going to stay right here for the last segment. Great guest coming up to close out the show. You stay with us. We'll be right back.
You've heard Paul Deltz playing the music on the Your Music Matters Morning Show. He is also an experienced mortgage loan officer working for U.S. Mortgage Corporation and assists homeowners navigate the reverse mortgage process. If you are finding yourself asking questions whether or not you set aside enough for retirement, Paul can sit down with you, your family, and your financial advisor and discuss how a reverse mortgage may be a valuable resource for your retirement plan. You will be responsible for paying your taxes and insurance, and the reverse mortgage can help with this and other expenses, such as home health care or other untimely bills. Put Paul's 20-plus years of experience to work for you, as choosing the right option for your situation can be critical. Call Paul at U.S. Mortgage Corporation at 877-213-9977. That's 877-213-9977. Or go to seniormatters.info for more information. U.S. Mortgage Corporation is a licensed mortgage banker in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, and Delaware, and an equal housing lender. NMLS number 3901. U.S. Mortgage Corporation is located at 201 Old Country Road, Suite 140, Melville, New York, 11747. This advertisement applies to first lien mortgages. Paul E. Dilks, NMLS, is 485904.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom, they would build a nation that would last with peace and liberty. It is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our Constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Biden of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. You may call us at area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
What does it take to be the leader in production systems technology? To be the one company that solves production problems at any plant, for any product, and with any technology? It takes a 30-year record of success. It takes total mastery of complex technologies with a history of delivering success every time, without fail. Only one company can claim that high ground in manufacturing line optimization, data automation, and systems integration, and that's Philadelphia Control Systems. In factories worldwide, Philadelphia Control Systems programs, software, and engineering solutions deliver optimal performance and output flow with a record that can't be matched. Any plant, any product, any technology. Philadelphia Control Systems, the leader in production automation since 1982. 800-335-9811. PCSforAutomation.com. That's PCS, the number 4, automation.com.
The Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We're establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired as I am about the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. on WNJC Radio, 1360 a.m., or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our websites, ConservativeCommandosRadioNetwork.com and CCRN.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where even more newsmakers go to be heard.
9/11. It's a day that will go down in our history as the most horrific and destructive scene ever to happen on American soil. It will also be, for most Americans who witnessed it either up close or simply watched in horror on TV, America to participate in a national memorial I call the United Action of Prayer this coming 9/11 and every 9/11 from then on.
United Action of Prayer is simply every American stopping whatever they are doing for 1 minute at precisely 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. to either observe 1 minute of silence or pray in memory for the 9/11 victims and their families, and perhaps a prayer of gratitude for living in a country where even 9/11 could not at all weaken the spirit of our great nation. From the East Coast to the West Coast and around the world on the Internet, we're coming to you live from the CCRS studios, WNJC 1360. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Show with your host, Rick Trader. The Conservative Commandos Radio Show, where the newsmakers go to be heard. You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
Thanks for staying with us. You are listening to the Conservative Commandos Radio Show. If you'd like to hear a rebroadcast of today's show, please check out our websites, ccrsnetwork.com and ccrshow.com. Or mornings at 9 a.m., log on to leadingedgeradionetwork.com. You can listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network at any time, any day, from any telephone by calling 832-999-1199. We're going to close out today with our final guest, Frank Vernuccio. He serves as editor-in-chief of New York Analysis of Policy and Government, providing objective coverage of key issues facing the United States today. Frank is co-host of the Vernuccio Novak Report, nationally heard each Thursday at 10 a.m., both on broadcast radio and on the web at amfm247.com, and on Saturday at 1 p.m. Eastern as part of the CCRN right here on WNJC. He also co-hosts the American Political Zone broadcast on cable in eastern Connecticut. In the aftermath of the 9/11, he was appointed by New York's Governor George Pataki to lead the then hard-hit New York County Workers' Compensation Board. And with that, let me say, Frank Vernuccio, welcome to the Conservative Commandos Radio
Show. Rick, it's great to be with you again.
It's great to have you. I think the subject we're going to kick around a bit for the next 20 minutes is attacks on Internet freedom. Why don't you pick that up and walk our audience through what's happening with the Internet?
Well, there's a couple of different assaults on Internet freedom. One, of course, is the president is talking about, again, surrendering control of the Internet from the ICANN organization, which is a private organization, to an international body, the International Telecommunications and Telegraph Union. It's a part of the United Nations. If indeed it is given to a United Nations subcommittee control, that would mean that countries like Russia, China, and Iran, who are part of that organization and who are desperately going for censorship, would have a significant control over what goes on and what stays off the Internet. It's a real threat. But also, there's other factors as well. You know, we know that this administration has a reputation for not particularly enjoying the concept of free speech. We know that they attempted to put FCC monitors in newsrooms. We know that they are talking about regulating the Internet, even within the United States, as though it were another public utility, like an electric company or the telephone company. All of these things added together pose real threats for the future of free speech on the Internet.
Now, what basis or justification does the Obama administration offer up for putting control of the Internet into international hands?
Rick, you're asking the absolutely perfect question, because the fact of the matter is, just like in the case of the strange Obama foreign policy, the administration has not been particularly forthcoming about the reason it decided to go with a more international control of the Internet, frankly, government control of the Internet, where before, the Internet, which is, I think most people would agree, is working very, very well and has grown exponentially thanks to the absence of government control of the Internet. So, you know, there really is no logical reason given. In terms of regulation of the Internet, although as though it were a public utility, that's part of the whole discussion of bandwidth and speed, where they want to do is to prevent ISP internet providers from giving more preference to, say, a big company than to a smaller user. Of course, there's no real evidence of that happening, and there's no reason that it has to try to solve a problem that doesn't exist yet. But nevertheless, that's the excuse that the administration has given.
So the reason is to prevent a problem from happening that's never yet happened.
And doesn't look likely to happen either, correct.
Okay, because I can speak from the consumer standpoint. I have a faster internet connection than I ever imagined could be technically possible even 5 years ago. Now, do I gripe about the price? Yeah, I always have, and I always will. But it's working out pretty well for me in terms of giving me choice performance at really a low price. I mean, I'm able to do things that were impossible to do on the internet 20 years ago, and or even 10 years ago. So that's free enterprise working.
That's absolutely right. And indeed, if you look at what you're able to do on the internet, you can put up a website, you can do all sorts of things. Now, imagine trying to do the same thing on TV or radio. You know, Rick, you're a great radio man. You know how difficult it is and how expensive it is to put a show on the radio or certainly on a TV network. Compare that to the internet. The internet is the greatest advance in free speech we've seen practically since the First Amendment was adopted. So there is no reason at all to attack that. There's no reason to try to cure a problem that doesn't exist. But they're not trying to cure a problem that doesn't exist. If you'd want to draw an analogy, I think you have to look at what the IRS tried to do with 501c4s. Any organization that disagreed with the president received a very difficult treatment in trying to set up a 501c4. And I think the purpose for what the administration is attempting to do with the internet under both the internationalization of it as well as the bandwidth problem or non-problem is to find a way really to control the internet, to clamp down on voices of dissent against the administration.
So it becomes a tool for them to kind of evaluate whether or not the Conservative Commandos radio show has enough social merit to deserve its full share of bandwidth. And in the minds of certain liberals, it's pretty certain that we would come up as a third-class member of society and we would be begging for bandwidth.
That's exactly right. And you only have to look at the difference in ratings between left-wing talk shows, Talk America, for example, that network, which and compare it with the success of conservative-oriented radio, whether you're talking about Rush Limbaugh and the Conservative Commandos. Certainly they provide something that the people are attracted to, and of course that raises the hackles of the administration.
Because any time that people are allowed to exercise their freedom of choice, that is very suspect in the minds of a hardcore leftist.
That's exactly right. And again, it's simply because in the marketplace of ideas, leftist ideas simply don't do very well. Now, there's a distinction, of course, between left-wing candidates and left-wing ideas. Interestingly enough, when you look at the polls, the vast and overwhelming majority of Americans support more conservative ideas. It doesn't always show up in elections, simply because, and I'm going to be very blunt about this, the Republicans, frankly, don't do a very great job politically. Watching the Republicans play politics against the Democrats is like watching a girls' softball league play against the New York Yankees. But when it comes to actual ideas and actual beliefs, the American people, I think, are solidly conservative.
Yeah, the Republican Party, certainly the leadership, has a problem that they come to the electorate every 2 or 4 years with a business plan. And the public is too busy to read the 75-page business plan. What they want to know is where is the vision and how does it make my life better? And that is something that Republicans have not done well since the days of Ronald Reagan. In fact, lately we haven't done it at all.
Rick, it's interesting. If you look just at, again, I'm not talking about the marketplace of ideas. I'm just talking about political smarts, getting petitions signed, doing ads, using the internet for political purposes. The Democratic Party has outclassed the Republican Party by an extraordinary measure. That's the real problem. The one area where our side of the ledger has been successful is in communications in terms of what we're saying in free speech on the internet, not affiliated with the party, but just with organizations like Conservative Commandos. That's been successful. And that is why the Democratic left is doing so, trying so hard to repress it. They don't like dissent. They don't like, frankly, they don't like competition. And so this is their way of fighting against it.
Frank, would you stay with us? We're going into a hard, we'll need about 3 minutes on this, and then we'll come back and have a short wrap-up.
That would be great.
Thanks so much. We have Frank Vernucci on the phone. He's talking about attacks on internet freedom. Where freedom lives, that's where you'll find liberals attacking. And stay with us. This is the Conservative Commandos Radio Show. I'm Kevin Wade. I'm joined by Rick Trader. We will be right back.
The Conservative Commandos Radio Show is expanding to become the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. We are establishing a front line of conservative radio broadcasters and ironclad patriots to declare war against the madness of liberalism and the Obama administration. Are you tired of the disregard for our Constitution? Do you still have faith in the American dream? Are you looking for sensible, smart radio? If so, listen to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network every weekday from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Saturdays from 2 to 6 p.m. on WNJC Radio, 1360 on your AM dial, or around the world on the internet at WNJCRadio.com. Check out our website, CCRSNetwork.com, for rebroadcasts and network updates. We are the Conservative Commandos Radio Network, where now even more newsmakers go to be heard.
Hi, this is Bob Vine, owner of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. I've had the opportunity to travel in many foreign countries, and I've seen what happens to people when they lose their freedom. I wrote this poem. Give us freedom was the cry as they marched throughout the night at Concord Bridge in Trenton. For freedom they would fight. To build a nation that would last with peace and liberty, it is a job that's never done if we are to be free. They wrote a declaration to announce that we are free, then a constitution for all the world to see. But this is ink on paper. We must make it last. It must always be defended, and that is quite a task. Today the battle rages for freedom in our land. To save our constitution, we all must take a stand. We must stand up for freedom in our actions every day, and you can stand up with us. Join the NRA. This is Bob Vidin of Bob's Little Sports Shop in Glassboro, New Jersey. At area code 856-881-7575 or visit us online at bobslittlesportshop.com.
9/11. It's a day that will go down in our history as the most horrific and destructive scene ever to happen on American soil. It will also be, for most Americans who witnessed it either up close or simply watched in horror on TV, America to participate in a national memorial I call the United Action of Prayer this coming 9/11 and every 9/11 from then on. United Action of Prayer is simply every American stopping whatever they are doing for 1 minute at precisely 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. to either observe 1 minute of silence or pray in memory for the 9/11 victims and their families, and perhaps a prayer of gratitude for living in a country where even 9/11 could not at all weaken the spirit of our great nation.
You can call the Conservative Commandos Radio Show at 856-227-1360. Your opinion counts at 856-227-1360.
This is Congressman Alan West, and you're listening to the Conservative Commando Radio Show.
You are listening to the Conservative Commandos Radio Network. I'm Kevin Wade. I'm joined by Rick Trader. I know you're expecting to hear Sharon Angle since it's a Monday, but she's in transit. That means she's between here and there going back home after her big weekend in Nashville. So safe travels, Sharon. And Rick, it's great to be with you. We have on the phone with us Frank Vernuccio, and he's been... Well, he's been giving us the big red flag about what the Obama administration is trying to do, continues to try to do with freedom of speech using this vehicle we call the Internet. And, Frank, thank you for staying with us.
Kevin, it's great being with you.
And there's no end to it. I mean, this nation invented the Internet. It works very, very well. It wasn't Al Gore. It was actually some scientists. but they did it on our dime, so we own it. And we've done a pretty fair job regulating it on behalf of the international community, as they say. And I agree with you, Frank. I mean, the invention of the Internet ranks right up there with the printing press in terms of making free speech available to everyone on the planet. And that is a juicy morsel for the liberals to try to grab out of our hands, because if you control the Internet, it's like controlling water running down a river. It happens without your permission.
Now, one of the startling developments over the past year or so was the introduction into the United States Senate of Senator Charles Schumer of New York's bill to amend the First Amendment. I still find it amazing that we're even saying those words. That, of course, came in response to the Citizens United decision. Senator Schumer wanted to amend the First Amendment in order to limit the amount of contributions you could use in terms of what you can say about a candidate that had to be counted as a contribution limit and so forth. But when it comes to the Internet, as mentioned before, there is absolutely no viable reason to do this. The administration still has not come up with a rationale why it has to do this, why it wants to give international control over the Internet. And if you look, as I have, at the minutes of some of the meetings with the United Nations of countries, again, like Russia, China, and Iran, they have as a real motivation censoring the Internet as much as possible. In fact, one of the more unusual things introduced, and I believe it was by the Russians, was a move that would allow a government, Russia, China, Iran, so forth, to actually sue someone for slandering a government on the Internet. So if, for example, I said, as I often do on my website, that Russia is no longer, should no longer be considered anything resembling a democracy. It is now an authoritative government. If Vladimir Putin decided to do that, under some of the proposals presented by the discussions at the United Nations, I could be sued by the Russian government for saying that Vladimir Putin's a dictator or that Russia was bloodthirsty in its invasion of Ukraine. So this is the depth to which freedom of the Internet is descending. And rather than standing athwart this and saying the United States will never permit this sort of thing from happening, the White House is actually facilitating this whole move. It's a disastrous move for free speech, inexplicable, and the American people deserve, one, an administration that doesn't do this, and B, they deserve an explanation as to what the administration's motivations are.
Now, Frank, I believe the conservatives across the fruited plains are you know, standing with you in terms of interpreting what this attack on the Internet means. But is this subject of kind of breaking down across the country into the typical two partisan groups where right-thinking people, conservatives, are up in arms about it and liberals don't see anything wrong with what the president is attempting to do?
There are some liberals who are starting to wake up. I think they're realizing that if something like this happened, they could be targeted at some point in the future as well. But for the most part, it's an issue, and you're exactly right, that conservatives are certainly placing on the front burner, while most leftists are simply either ignoring the issue or on the wrong side of the issue. But we have to be realistic and be very blunt about this, not be politically correct. The fact of the matter is, the left has never been particularly comfortable with the concept of free speech. For most of their tenets to be exercised, for most of their goals to be reached, you do have to have a certain amount of heightened control over the public. And I think this dovetails very nicely with their point of view.
Regrettably so. Frank, tell our audience how to keep up with your writings, musings, and your next radio appearance.
Well, of course, I'm on the Conservative Commandos radio program, so that's one way. And our website, which is the easiest way to get in touch, you can listen both to our radio show and our TV show, as well as look at the new column we post every day, Monday through Saturday, at usagovpolicy.com.
usagovpolicy.com.
That's it.
Frank Vernuccio, thank you so much for joining us today on the Conservative Commandos Radio Network.
It was great being with you, and keep up the wonderful work. You're a beacon of hope in a land that certainly needs it.
Thank you, Frank. Rick, we've got about 2 minutes.
You know, Kevin, is my mic on there?
Now it is. You know, Kevin, as you and Frank were speaking about the internet, you mentioned something that you think it costs you a lot of money. In my opinion, the internet is something that works. As far as a monopoly goes, the internet is anything but a monopoly, because everybody can get their view out there, everybody can get their opinion out there, everybody can talk about their business out there. If there is anywhere that in my opinion, the internet can be improved, is if there is more competition. However, regulation does just a fact. The regulations inhibits competition. I would love to see more competition in the internet. My opinion, that would make it better.
Yeah, I mean, when I said, you know, I think it's a little bit pricey, but
yeah,
I've always felt that. But yeah. The fact is, it reinvents itself.
It does.
I mean, the speed of connection that I have today is just unbelievable for the price I'm paying. Mm-hmm. Would I like to pay $10 less a month? Sure, I would. But the fact is, it's free enterprise and competition. Different technologies, different service providers.
Absolutely.
Okay,
well,
we're out there trying to outdo one another to please me, that have given me this 15 megabaud download speed for about, you know, $45-$50 a month at home.
Mm-hmm.
And that's unimaginable to someone who remembers 9600 baud dial-up over a telephone and thinking that was like unbelievable.
Well, the only good thing about that 9600 baud, at least through Juno, it used to be free. Not so free anymore.
Well, the Conservative Commandos Radio Show is coming to you free, my friends, and
yes,
the listening audience, and we are coming to the end of this show on Monday, August 31. You want to make a quick goodbye, and I'll sign us off, Rick?
No, you're doing a great job, Kevin. I won't say goodbye today, other than we'll see you tomorrow on the radio. Kevin?
Rick, it's always a pleasure. It's a pleasure to be in the studio. I want to thank Mateo for being with us. And as always, God bless, Godspeed, and may God save the United States of America.
Once again, liberal bigotry rears its ugly head. Hello, I'm Ron Edwards. On today's page from the Edwards Notebook, as of now, if you are a Christian high school graduate and are considering a higher education, just beware that the Community College of Baltimore has joined the growing list of American colleges and universities that openly discriminate against Christians. No more is it just the dirty look or a snide remark, but as Mather Clark of the American Center for Law and Justice put it, public colleges and universities are taking the gloves off when it comes to Christian students on their college campi. Christian students can now expect applications to be rejected if they let it be known that they are a person of faith. Now, if you are a unnatural sexual practitioner or a mangy Muslim at war with America and all non-Muslims, hey, no problem. You get to the head of the class. One Christian student, Brandon Jenkins, was flat out rejected at the Community College of Baltimore after honestly answering an admission interview question, what was the most important thing in his life? To which young Brandon answered, my God. Thus he was, this is no place for religion. Funny thing though, bigoted campus liberals didn't refuse any Muslim students strolling around. Gee, I wonder why. I'm Ron Edwards.